Bonjour tout le monde. Here I am again. How is the Sunday going? Because I'm recording this video today, Sunday. Welcome or welcome back. Je m'appelle Kiki et je suis là pour vous aider. I'm here to give you as much information as possible to make your trip, visit or stay in France as comfortable and as stressless as possible by sharing my own information and understanding from my own experience. So today's video is going to be about finding accommodation in France, about my experience and the tips that can help you when you are trying to get accommodation in France, and the documents and things you might need. If my voice sounds a bit different because I have a serious case of allergies caused by pollen. You know, this is a spring season, so there's a lot of flowers and things, so it kind of irritates me, and yeah, I have stuffy nose, and you know how allergies work, so that's how it is. So about accommodation in France. So when my first visits to France were always with a host family or with in a student hostel kind of situation, which was very affordable, and it was okay, and it was for short terms. 7 days, 1 week, 2 weeks. Highest I stayed was 3 weeks, and then I would come back, and everything was organized by the institution that was giving the French courses. So when I planned on coming to France for my master degree, I had to look for accommodation myself because the university is not the same as the institution I went for my teacher training. The university itself does not offer any assistance for that, so I had to look for accommodation. At first I found an Airbnb, but by the time I got to Campus France and I told them that this is what I wanted to present to the embassy, they said the embassy does not accept Airbnb. And remember, I was going with children, so my own kind of accommodation could not be typical student accommodation. So they refused. I showed them a couple of other options and they told me it wouldn't work for the embassy. So the next option I had, I went on the student site and I saw student hostels and student accommodation. And then the one I think it was Stud City, I clicked on it and I started communicating with their contact person, and I told them this is the situation, and they told me the biggest arrangement they would have would be a one-bedroom apartment, self-contained, where 4 people can stay in. So eventually that's what I went for. So by the time I told them, they said the condition was that I would need to pay 3 months of rent in advance, you know, because I was not on ground in France to sign any documents, and I needed a lease to present to the embassy, because the embassy will only accept a signed lease, you know, for accommodation in France. So that was what they did. They sent me all the documents after I paid for 3 months in advance, and that lease is what I used to pay for. That's what I used to apply for my embassy, my visa, my student visa, and it was granted to me. Meanwhile, the accommodation was what they call a T2, that's a T2, a living room and a bedroom. The living room had a chair which converted into a double bed. It had a corner kitchen, like a studio, and it had TV, it was furnished. The other room had a bed as well. There were wardrobes in it, and you know, so that's where I and my 3 children came into for the first couple of months we were in France. In that accommodation, I was paying for electricity, and I was paying for I was just paying for electricity, because everything, the cooking, the fridge, the heating, was all electrical. There was no gas, so I was paying for that. The rent itself was already quite pricey for me, but it was just, my plan was that I would stay there for some months and use that time to look for a more comfortable apartment or house for a family. That was my intention. You know, unbeknownst to me that it would be really difficult, especially since I didn't know anyone. And in France, I would say that it's somehow like in Nigeria, like before you can rent an apartment, you have to have a guarantor. You know, someone that the landlord would feel comfortable renting out an apartment to a known person, because you don't know if this can pay. You know, so it took me about 8 months. I spent dearly for those 8 months because I was paying for the rent of the apartment, which was 650 euros, and then I was paying for electricity as well, which went as high as 200 some months. So you can imagine at the end of each month I was paying almost up to 800 euros, and 8 months of that. So I was really, really panicking, looking for accommodation. I would go for house sightings, and then it would look like everything is okay, but once they hear that, oh, you're a student, you're a single mother, you have kids, then it just wouldn't work out. I wasn't getting any help, and I didn't really know anyone. So eventually it was my class teacher in the university, my course teacher, who I explained the situation to, and she's very open-minded, and we were really close because I was an older and more mature student, so we were able to relate from time to time. So when I told her that this is a situation that I really need a guarantor, she told me that, okay, I'm not rich, so you have to assure me that you can pay the rent. I'll be your guarantor. I'll give you my French ID card. I'll give you my payslips for you to present, because that's the document you need to present when you are getting accommodation. And that's what she did. And I assured her that I would make sure nothing, because if you don't pay your rent, automatically they will write to your guarantor and they will have access to your guarantor's account and remove the money if you don't pay. So that's why a lot of people are, hardly would you find anyone that will be willing to be a guarantor for you if they don't know you, you know, and stuff like that. So she really took a chance, and till now I'm so grateful, because that's what gave me, you know, the first accommodation we moved to, which was a tétoir, 2 bedrooms, living room, bathroom, toilet, and kitchen, you know. So that accommodation was upstairs, and based on my experience, I want to tell you some tips that you should look out for when you are trying to apply or trying to get accommodation in France, whether you're already, and this is assuming that you're already in France, because when you are getting accommodation and you are in Nigeria or in another country coming to France, it might take, you can't check it yourself, so you're going to have to take what you're given, or if you can find someone on ground already who can go there and check it and make sure all the right questions are asked. You found an accommodation that you like, and you've contacted the agency. It could be an agency or an individual that you like to have a look at it, and they are willing to set up a date. You go there, but you come with the documents like your identity. If you have to show proof of your income, if you're a salary earner, show your employment letter, and then your pay slips, your last 3 pay slips. Then also you have to, if you're a student, you have to show that, you show your admission letter that you're a student in school, and you have to show who is sponsoring you, and you know your source of income. Then if you don't have a job or where your revenue is coming in, if you have a guarantor, it's your guarantor that will now supply all these documents. Meaning that if you default, it's your guarantor that will pay. And so once you have all those documents together, getting the accommodation should be, you know, a walkthrough. But the reality of it, because I went through it, is that sometimes some landlords do not want to rent to, maybe you're black, you know, or you're a foreigner. They prefer French. And I don't want to say it in the context of being racist, because it's just that some people are just not comfortable, you know, relating with people that are not like them. So I wouldn't say it's outright racism. So sometimes they may not tell you, but you just find that you are making an appointment, but the minute they discover you're a foreigner or you're black, you just find that, oh, the council is no longer available, or somebody else has rented it. That's what they tell you. They give you a real walk around, you know. So at the end of the day, I had to use an agency. So the agency's job, yes, the rent is a little bit more expensive than the actual owner would have put it. But the truth is that the agency's business is that you can pay. You prove to them that you can pay. They don't look at your nationality or anything like that. And they even told me that, oh, if you need a guarantor, if you have someone even working back home in Nigeria, the person can serve as a guarantor. So, oh, wow, I didn't know that. But my teacher had already served as a guarantor for me, and I was determined that there would be no such, you know, story. I don't want to embarrass or bring trouble to anyone. So when I moved into the apartment, the questions I should have asked, those are tips I'm giving you. You have to find out if the apartment is well insulated. There's water, I mean, that air doesn't come in through the glasses during the winter, because that will make your electricity bill higher. Most people won't tell you that. You have to ask if it's well insulated. You have to ask if the building is you know, well plastered and made. Because if you're not careful, if you go into an apartment that the wall is like cardboard, when you make noise, neighbors will always complain and you won't enjoy staying in that apartment. That's the second mistake I made. The apartment I took was upstairs. The building was not thick, well made, so we could hear everything. And then even insulated, I didn't ask. So air used to come in during the winter. It was an old building, you know, that had been remodeled, you know. So my electricity bill was very high. And then the heater was an old heater of almost 20 years old. I didn't know. So I really spent, so before the house heats up, it will consume lots of energy. So I was paying through my nose for that, you know, but I was just happy that the rent was much lower. It was a bigger space for me and my kids. And so that's why I didn't ask this question. And that's what I'm telling you now, so that you know what to ask. Okay, some other tips that might help you, just some quick tips that you should ask the landlord when you're having the siting of the house is, what was the previous tenant's gas bill like, if it's gas or electricity. Ask them what they were paying. Find out how close you are to transportation. Hope it's not an isolated area where it's difficult to get transportation. You should try and find that out. Ask about what facilities are available, like walking distance shops, medical clinic, pharmacy, post office, and things like that. You can ask. It's not it's not something that should be a deal breaker, but you just know yourself and you know what you can take or not. And then when you're in the house doing the inspection, make sure you check for hot and cold water if it's working. Check for mold or moist near the windows. That's important so that you know what kind of building it is. And then, you know, try to find out if the building is well insulated, like I told you before. These are the two things you should ask them. And then when you're signing the lease, in the lease they should have your name, the name of the owner of the property, how much you're going to pay, who was in the apartment before you moved in, you know. And just try and go through the document, and also have someone, a French, if you have a French contact or a friend that can help you look through it to see if there are any loopholes in it that can, you know, make things difficult for you later. So these little tips is just about finding accommodation in France. It's not for the faint-hearted, especially if you don't know anyone. I didn't know a soul when I came here, so I really paid dearly for that. And but it doesn't have to be like that for everyone, you know. If, since, you know, a lot of people are students coming here, there's more arrangement for international students. You can probably get your accommodation in Cruz. Cruz is like the government student housing. And in France, you are entitled to, another point I would like to for you to take note of is that if you're in France, you are entitled to housing allowance as an international student. The housing allowance is between 170 to, it could be more than that. But once you come in and you find your accommodation, you contact CAF. CAF is the Caisse d'Allocation Familiale. They're the ones in charge of you know, allocations and all the subventions that the government might give to you. But you are automatically, if you come into France as an international student, you're automatically entitled to housing allowance. It might be a little bit up to half of what you might pay, or it might be less, but it's, you know, it's an assistance and it's better than nothing. So immediately you're into your apartment, you sign the lease, you contact the CAF, you know, and then they will now connect to your bank account and make sure it's either paying directly to your landlord or it's paid directly to your account to assist with your accommodation. But you know, if you're not a student and you're actually a permanent legal resident in France, if you have kids with you, your rent can be so low because they'll take into account the children that you have. That was not my own case. The reason being that I came in as a student, and officially they say that because my children came in with me as a student, that they are not entitled to any form of consideration from the government. So there's nothing like that. But just for others who might come in through other ways, maybe this information will help you to research further. Now, the cost of rent can depend on where you're staying in France. If you're in Paris, that's the most expensive place to live. So if you're a student, you can be paying as much as 1,000, 1,500 for a studio, which is, you know, really small, you know. And then if you go to other regions that are not Paris, you might be paying between 800 and 1,000. And if you come to the less busy or less popular places, like where I am in Auvergne, Clermont-Ferrand, you can pay as low as 250 for student residence, and then, you know, as high as maybe 600 or 600. But really, if you want more comfort, you know, but it ranges from 200 to 600 for students' accommodation. You know, but I can't really talk about what I am paying because I'm living in a proper apartment that, you know, it's for my family. But maybe in another video, if you're interested in finding out how family accommodation works in France, like if you're trying to find accommodation for your family, please leave a comment down in the comments below so that I can work on getting more information for you. And so with this, I've come to the end of this video about accommodation in France. I told you about my own story, a little bit about it, and then the tips and tricks that you should look out for when you are trying to find accommodation in France. If there's anything that I'm missing or I wasn't really thorough and you want more clarification, please kindly leave a comment below, then I'll make a video about that. And then guys, I really need you to like, subscribe, and also share my video to people you think that it would be useful to, so that we can grow a bit more. And if you go on my YouTube banner, you'll find links to my email, to my calendar, if you want to book time to talk. I have free 30 minutes if you want a free talk, and there's also for the paid full consultation if you want to really go deeper for you in terms of research and other things and information. And then there's also my TikTok, you can follow me there if you want, just to know how my daily life is, the real deal, you know. And then please leave comments, let me know what area you like me to talk about, which you like to know, and let me see how I can share more information. So thanks for watching today, and don't forget to like, to share, subscribe, so that we can grow. And just remember that I'm here, I'm very willing, I'm very open with information, so just, you know, do not hesitate to reach out and ask through email, through my calendar, or wherever for information. And then, so my lovely French teachers, to end this video, I have a little bonus. I found some information that might be useful for French teachers. If you're trying to develop yourself and train yourself as a French teacher, and you know, resources are not really available, but you just want to make an effort and get certification, you know, as you go to trainings, I have I don't know if I told you that I used to do certifications on Maison de Langue. I'm going to put the link in my description box for those that want to earn a certificate or two. One of the programs is free, the other one is paid, but the paid is not really that much, about 27 euros, and then you get a certificate at the end of the training. The training lasts for maybe an hour or two, it's not that long, but it's a good certificate to have if you're trying to build your qualifications as a French teacher and, you know, move to higher things, so, and also to get more knowledge, of course. So I'm going to quickly show you how I go into the link and how you can register for it as a teacher. And it's not just limited to teacher, if you're just interested in French and want to develop yourself, this program is, and this particular training will be for you. So just follow the next video. So for my wonderful professeur de français, I'm always on the lookout for things that can help, you know, from wherever you are. So this is an institution that I used to do a lot of programs with, Maison de Langue. It's virtual, it's not, I've never been to the actual place. So they organize workshops online. Some of them are free, some of them are not. The ones that are being paid for are not so expensive, it's affordable, especially if you want to have a certificate at the end of the training to add to whatever you have in your teaching portfolio, you know, just to have certification and also increase your knowledge, interact with other French teachers. As you can see, the theme for it, PAC Pédagogique Evaluation, on the 11th of May and the 18th of May. The one of 11th of May is already passed, so we're not going to look at that, but it was free. The one for the 18th of May is also free, and it's on the same theme. Let me show you how I get to the registration, how you register for it. You can see right here, there's a descriptive A on its inscription. So I'm clicking on it and it takes me to the registration page. So you can see here already the title, the organizers, the time and the date, as you can see, and an explanation of what the whole program is about and the
interlocutor, the person that's going to speak, you know. So you see everything here on this page when you click on that link, and I'm going to put the link under in the description box so you can go ahead and benefit from it. So you see here it is gratuite, Sanskrit. So I'm going to click on Sanskrit, and once you go to the registration page, that's it. You can order how many places you want, 1, 2, 3, 4. Of course, it's only one anyway, you know. So once we take what we want, then you can click on Sanskrit, and then once you're in, you put in your details and everything, put in your address, they do a short survey, ask some questions, and then this button, this Sanskrit button, will turn green once you put all the information inside. That's it there. So let me go back. Then the second one, which is the Parcours Pédagogique Phonétique on the 25th of May, which is quite interesting. Le français est-il si difficile à prononcer? For teachers, I think it would be interesting for you to develop yourself and also to teach better, even if you're teaching adults or children. So you can see it's $27.90, and I think it's, yeah, it's costing something, but it depends on your interest and what you want to develop. Once you click on it, it's the same way. When you click on it, the link, which I'm going to put down, you see everything you need, all the information, what they're going to talk about, organizers. See? Wonderful. Then click on Sanskrit, which is, takes you to the registration page. Of course, here, you're going to have to put in your card details. Let me open it. Yeah, so now we're here. You put in all your details, information, and then at the end, I think, yes, you have to pay either with your credit card or PayPal, you know. So that's it. And then once you pay, once you've made your choice, you'll be able to click commander, which is to order. So that's that, my French teachers. I hope you can make use of it, whether the free or the paid one, and I hope this helps.
And on this note, I just want to say bonne soirée, because I'm in the evening here, and I'm just saying have a good evening, and keep, you know, pushing, keep doing every little thing you can do. Remember that I'm available. I'm hoping that you're all well. I know that I just jumped right into the video. We didn't really have time to exchange. Let me know if you would like me to do it live, either on YouTube or Instagram. And I appreciate you guys. I really thank you for those that are following me. I see you, you know, and let me know how we can interact more. You know, I'm learning as you are also learning a lot of things from me. I'm also trying to learn and do better on this channel. And so Nigeria to France, I leave you with good wishes, good feelings, and good hope. Okay.